Welcome to 2 Month Review. This is Chad Post from Open Letter Books, and I'm here as always with Brian Wood. And this is our weekly podcast in which we take one book and break it down bit by bit, section by section, talking about it, making jokes, trying to show that these kind of books can be entertaining. I'm having technical difficulties too. This has been a bit of a mess this morning. Tom Flynn is going to join us this week as a special guest. He's been on a few times. He's from Volumes Bookstore, but he's having problems getting his sound to work. So for now, I guess it's just you and me, Brian. So how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Chad.
And I didn't say this at the top, but we are this season we're reading Pessoa's The Book of Disquiet, this particular New Directions edition, which is the complete and I think they use another word too, but the complete edition, which is interesting because it's something I want to talk about later today. But
it's so arrogant. So arrogant. My goodness. We have the complete edition. I mean, come on, you guys. Jeez.
Complete revised.
The ultimate.
I almost said unedited, which is the wrong word. Unabridged.
I want the director's cut. The final cut, it's like, I don't know, as long as it's not the theatrical cut, I'll take it.
Very true. So actually, while we're waiting for him and we can get started on stuff, let me banter for a second. So this is the earlier edition of Margaret Jill Costa's translation. So Margaret Jill Costa did this version that we're reading, but earlier she did this version, which is published by Serpent's Tail. And this I've owned since, I'm going to say it's 1990. It's published in 1991. So I've owned this for a while. I didn't get it in 1991, but, 20 years ago or whatever. And this isn't the version I read. There's another version that it will bring up later in a different podcast from Richard Zenith. But I wanted to see like how these two compared last night after I was going through it, because obviously these are very, very vast different sizes. So this one, the Serpent's Tail one, was edited.
Of course, you picked the bigger one that requires more reading. Thank you, Chad.
I'm going to get to that point in a second. Yeah, okay. I know. This is the new one. But okay, so this version was edited by Maria Jose de la Lancastra, whereas the one that we're reading was edited by Jerónimo Pizarro. And he's going to be on the podcast next week. So for everyone who's listening to this, he'll be joining us and he can talk about how he edited and what his choices were in doing this. Obviously, there's two very different books. The Book of Disquiet, this version, only references the fact that Bernardo Soares is the author of the Book of Disquiet, which in our version is only referenced in the second half of it. So we have a whole opening part, which we talked about a bit with Declan last week, of how this is two books, a book that was written in the early 1900s and then the one that's written in the 1930s. In the 1930s, Bernardo Soares one is much closer to this version, is mostly here, whereas the sections that we're going to be talking about for the next X number of weeks, and especially today, are from this, what's the guy's name? Vicente Guedes, who is a different heteronym of Pessoa's and is a whole nother section of this book, which is kind of the topic that I wanted to talk to you guys about. But one thing that's funny is this book, this version, opens with the introduction to Bernardo Soares. And it's the same as the introduction in our section that we're talking about today. So like on page...
1917 on page 3.
Yes, the preface. So installed on the upper floors of certain respectable taverns, that's the same exact opening that's in both of these. However, in this one, it's referring to Bernardo Soares. And in our version that we're talking about, it's talking about Vicente Guedes. Like this one ends, the earlier version ends with the line that's like, rented room after supper and spent the night writing, and then there's a gap and it says, so I met Vicente Guedes in our edition. That whole rest of this introduction isn't in the earlier version. And what's crazier is that all of the sections, so for anyone who's listening and following along, we're talking about pages 1 through 46. It's sections 1 through 38, because every bit of this book is numbered. So there's section 1, 2, blah, 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 blah. And that's the same case in this version of Book of Disquiet. However, as you can see, the numbers are like there's two. There's a number 1 and then in parentheses a number 90 in this case. And they refer to the 1982 version of the Book of Disquiet and then this version that they were using for their numbering. The only one that I could find that matched up is, with my quick search, is this one, which is number 15 in the earlier version and then in parentheses 20. That is chapter number 399 in our version. Same ones. So we have a lot more stuff and in a totally different organization than the versions in the past, which is something that Declan talked about and what New Directions wanted to do. But given like these differences and given the fact that you point out how big this is, I was curious what you guys thought about that general choice as a starting point, because this is a much different sort of book that we're going to be reading compared to the versions that have existed prior to this. Also, hi, Tom.
Hi. Y'all can hear me okay or no?
We can hear you now. So, Tom, Jesus. Welcome back.
And I just dropped off.
You're back.
Oh, I'm back. Okay.
Yeah. Hey, Tom. Good to see you.
Hey. Good to see you. You'd think after doing this every season, I would actually know how to get on or maybe get a new laptop in the meantime. But yeah, so that's been a great.
Have you read Pessoa before, or is this your first?
I've dipped in and out. Uh-huh. I have the Serpent's Tail version that Margaret Yale Costa did previously. And uh-huh. I picked up the Penguin Classic that Richard Zenith did, but I never did a straight read through. I would just kind of dip into a little bit. As often happens, I think, where at least booksellers of my generation, like someone would read it and start raving about it. And so everyone else would just sort of check out a little bit of it and that sort of thing. But yeah, it's interesting. I started going back to the Penguin, Richard Zenith one, and actually like doing a comparison of the translations, especially the prefaces, the other night. And it's interesting how different they are. And I think as Chad was talking about what gets lopped off and the rearrangement of the sections and all that. So yeah, that was, yeah.
Yeah, because I just, you know, I've never even really heard of them until this edition came out, and I saw a bunch about it on LitHub. They were all raving about the cover, how great it is, all that kind of stuff. So it was on my radar in that way, but I don't know anything about Portuguese literature. I mean, I don't know anything about literature in general, but but this seems like it'd be kind of like a researcher or academic's dream. Like this is never going to die because there's so many different ways to put it together,
It appeals to pretty much every version of the humanities student, you know, like, you know, the metatextual component to it. What does it actually mean? Playing around with the organization, all like the heteronym component alone, like it's just fertile ground for people just into it.
Who's the author? Forever. Who's the collector? Who's the
exactly?
Yeah, it's a rabbit hole.
A fun one, though, I think.
Yeah, when I was reading this preface in the version, the New Directions versions that we're reading, I thought the preface was written by Bernardo Soares talking about collecting the what's his name, Vicente Guedes.
Yeah.
And like Pessoa's not anywhere in this beginning part. Is that incorrect?
I always started as Pessoa introducing the rest of the book.
Yeah.
That he met this character and the rest of the book is that character's writings.
Right. Okay. That's how I read it. Like Pessoa sort of as the framework and then the writings being the various heteronyms.
Okay. So this preface part is Pessoa discussing, I met this guy, you know, who's
but then it's also like Pessoa the writer, Pessoa the voice versus Pessoa the person, which again goes back to that whole like metatextual, et cetera,
especially popping up in a footnote about the literary journal. That is one of the finest literary journals of avant-garde literature. That happens to be started by Pessoa. I'm glad you read that because it's so good.
I really like how there's that footnote, and then there's the footnote further on about the saddest book in all of Portugal and all Portuguese literature. And I like how the footnotes are really just sort of making sure we understand that Pessoa is name-dropping himself at different points, like so we get that part of the sense of humor. That was pretty great. Like a light use of footnotes like that is phenomenal.
Oh, you know, I meant to look this up, but is Antonio Nobre, is that a real person or was that one of his heteronyms?
Ah, shit. I didn't even think about that.
I meant to double check when I was reading this because I thought that would be really funny if it's one of his heteronyms. Because that's the person who, to make it clear, Antonio Nobre is the other footnote who wrote one volume of poetry called Alone, which he himself described as the saddest book in Portugal. he was a real poet. He was real. Yeah. I think. I mean, it's Wikipedia.
Who knows? Like for all we know, how many of the major poets in early 20th century Portuguese literature were actually Pessoa or a friend of his just playing a game.
It'd be a really like deep game if New Directions invented all sorts of Wikipedia pages for various like
oh my god, that's so great. That'd be so wonderful.
That would be wonderful. So what are you guys' general impressions of these first sections? I mean, I think you were talking when our Wi-Fi dropped out. I heard the part of it where you're saying that you had never read it in order either, Tom, which is like the most common theme. Like, I'll talk to various people who are like, oh, I love the Book of Disquiet, and be like, oh, have you read it in full? And they're like, no, I dip in and out, or I've read bits and pieces of it. Mm-hmm. It's not really a book designed to be read front to back, I guess. And that's kind of where it's like does feel a little bit more aligned with poetry than it does with like a novel, definitely the novel. But how did you feel trying to read this first section in that sort of straightforward 1 through 39 way?
I mean, I think it's tricky in that you are trying to read it as a sequential piece. And certainly there are some thematic elements to it, but like it isn't really sequential. I mean, it's really, a lot of it is going over, the various portions are going over sort of similar ideas, but taking different tacks at them. What I thought was interesting is that the pieces do, I think, get stronger as it moves along. Like the voice gets a little bit more clear, and some of the ideas that that he's playing with somehow come across a little bit in a slightly more interesting fashion, I think.
I'll second that.
I mean, at times it sounds, you know, honestly, sometimes it sounds like a live, like a live blog. Like, you know, it just sounds like someone throwing, you know, their pain against the wall of the internet sort of thing.
There are a few other, and, like, I remember how that feels.
I mean, really, right? And other times it's, you know, freaking, it's really great. It's really brilliant. So yeah, that's interesting. I think it'll be interesting to kind of track as we get deeper into it, how that changes, if it changes. Like, you know, is this fundamentally Vicente Guedes, like that personality, that Jerónimo's perspective? And at times it'll be great writing, and at times it'll feel more like maudlin musings, or like, is he actually refining as he goes along? And that'll be an interesting thing to sort of check out.
It is one of the questions I have for the guy next week, is like, how much of this is supposed to be, how much of this is just like, we've put everything that we found of his writing into a book, versus how much of it was what Pessoa would have put into the book himself? Like, is it like what you're saying, refined? Like, if Pessoa had organized this, would he have included all these sections, or were they like variations on a theme so that he could keep rewriting them until he gets the points that he would collect into a smaller version?
Yeah, I'm curious to hear what he would say about that. I mean, on some level, Pessoa leaving it behind the way he did.
It's like a sheaf of papers, right? Like, it's just like shit in trunks.
It's like trunks. It's trunks with like random bits of paper in it. Yeah. So like how much Pessoa gets to have a say in it, I think. And I think that was deliberate. You know, as much as I think this was his art, he was also clearly enjoying himself and clearly playing a bit of the game. And part of the game is, all right, you found this. How would you put it together? You know, so choose your own adventure of a classic Portuguese literature.
I had this down in my notes to bring up towards the end, but it makes more sense now. Is I don't know if either of you have read the book, The Museum of Eterna's novel, the first good novel by Macedonio Fernandez. He was an Argentine writer who was writing slightly before Pessoa, but more or less contemporary. And Macedonio was Borges's mentor for like long period of time. And he's like a crazy guy in himself and created a myth. He ran for governor just by putting his like name Macedonio on like note cards and leaving them at cafes because he believed it would like infiltrate the voting public because of the uniqueness of his name. He's like crazy dude. He tried to found a utopia. Awesome. But in the book of the Museum of Eterna's novel, it's the first half of it are all these prefaces to various people. It's like preface after preface after preface. And it's all like this big game. And there's one recurring bit that's about the skip around reader, where he's like anti people who just leaf through books and don't read them in order, don't read them like the way that the author wanted them to, but they're just like jumping around to skim and like be like a dilettante that understands something. And so he decides to make his book completely disordered and nonlinear, because then when you're skipping around, it'll end up being the story that he wanted you to find, because you'll find it by reading this way. And in a way, this book sort of fits that mold, like the jumping around, like you could create your own sort of version of these heteronyms by like not reading it sequentially or in order. It suits that almost better than trying to read it straight through.
Yeah.
Cool.
It's absurd. It's all absurd.
Life life is suffering.
Yeah.
Which sections did you, so another question I had for you guys is, how would you define, if like his heteronyms are supposed to be these sort of standalone entities that have a particular philosophical view and style of writing, a style of approach to the world, how would you define Vicente Guedes so far?
He feels kind of courtly and stoic to me.
Stoic was one that I wrote down too. How about you, Tom?
Yeah, I think stoicism is probably accurate. I mean, I'm terrible at like where different writing styles or movements take place in history and how they interact with each other. But this definitely seems, if I'm saying it right, probably like just before modernism, like just before a modernist approach, definitely symbolist and romantic in terms of its influences. Mm-hmm. But I could be totally showing my ass there and be totally wrong about that analysis.
No, whatever. I mean,
well, that makes sense because it wasn't a big thing with modernism, the Great War, which is like 1914-ish or something like that.
Right.
This is
19... I like put a big question after World War I.
1914? Like, question mark.
I guess.
Well, I don't know. When does a war start? Who knows? Like, just pick a date.
There was an event in that case. There was an assassination. That was the start of that.
Oh, it was like a duke. It wasn't even like a real person.
Wow.
I mean, come on. You didn't even get like a prince. You got like a whatever. Come on. Go big.
Yeah.
If you're going to dynamite a car, go big, man. Come on.
Oh, my goodness. All right.
Wow. Lincoln, that's an assassination. Yeah. Right? He didn't get like Lincoln's cousin. it wasn't Jedediah Lincoln at the horse fair. No, it was Abraham at the theater. Boom. No, but like, so this is 1913. So it's kind of on the cusp of when that, you know, but you do kind of, you feel that same sentiment as modernists where it's like kind of hopeless and
well,
and
but also,
sad,
I mean,
and
The Portuguese Empire as such has already pretty much come to an end. I mean, like, they had a little bit of a run into the...
When is
I mean,
the
they still had holdings. I mean, they still held on to, like, Angola and whatnot for a while. But, like, Portugal is they still had a little bit of power, I thought, in the late 19th century. And this was pretty much wrapping up at this point. So, mm-hmm. like, there's definitely that sense, I think, of, like, an era coming to an end. That this is already, like, in a state of decay, as it were.
Yeah, and in relation to the modernism thing too, it's like all about the internality of thought and like that becoming representative of something more universal by focusing solely on the interior, which this does have remnants of because he's never really talking about the world outside. It's all like his dream and his idea.
Right.
It's like the part that like the sort of stoicism on page 27, there's a paragraph that I marked with that where it says, it's in 25, the ideal would be to undertake no more action than the false action of a fountain, rising only to fall in the same place, glittering pointlessly in the sunlight and making a noise in the silence of the night that would set any dreamer dreaming of rivers an absent smile on his lips. It's sort of that stoicism of like, he doesn't want to do anything. Like it constantly, the through this first section, the constant refrain is like, don't act, don't engage with the world, only dream, nothing. And if you do anything, then that's the disquiet. Like life is disquiet because by acting, you are interfering with something that otherwise would be perfect and pristine outside of you in a way.
Yeah, like if you touch it, you shatter your dream.
Yeah.
But if you leave it alone, the dream can be alive, yeah.
Right, like I'm jumping ahead to like my favorite line that we usually do at the end, but page 35, I think it's section 32 or something like that.
Yeah,
always wanting to finish early. Typical.
It's the epiphany of the absurd section, but where he goes, so why am I writing this book? Because I recognize that it is imperfect. Were I to dream it, it would be perfection. The mere fact of writing makes it imperfect, which is why I am writing it. I mean, like, it's tying into this sort of sensibility. I mean, like, he does so much talking about as well, like, dreams versus seeing versus dreams. Which is, yeah.
The the one in, the related to that on 20 page 29 section 28 aesthetics of indifference has what the dreamer should try to feel for any object is the utter indifference that is as objects provoke in him, reminding me of David Lynch in Twin Peaks in the most recent season of The Dreamer.
Oh God, that didn't
boom! Jeez. I was waiting for that one. I marked that down a couple days ago. I was like, not gonna tell Brian.
All right, Cash in your bets if you thought he would talk about baseball.
This is what I was going to say. We should have a pool going to see, like, at what minute mark does Chad roll out with the Twin Peaks reference, and how many can he fit in per season?
If you're playing 2 month review bingo at home, you're just covered.
Yeah.
You should actually make a bingo card for the next season.
I kind of feel like it would be fun. I think that was sort of a joke, and then I realized that's kind of a great idea. Really, that too, like, and the same themes. Page 30 has a section that relates where it says, "In order not to demean ourselves in our own eyes, it is enough that we should become accustomed to harboring no ambitions, passions, desires, hopes, impulses, or feelings of disquiet." And that sort of stoicism, I think, was the thing that was most notable to me in terms of trying to understand this heteronym's sort of viewpoint on life. That, and there's moments at the beginning where it's more nihilistic, but I think it advances as he writes and becomes less nihilistic. Like on page 16, there's, "May the dawn never break, and may I in this whole room and the atmosphere to which I belong be distilled into night, into absolute darkness, and let nothing remain of me, not even a shadow that defiles with my memory whatever is left behind." That sort of nihilism is replaced by the sort of indifference and, like, and being enamored with what can be imagined or dreamed versus does the disturbance of living in everyday life, which I think is a slightly more nuanced sort of appreciation of what his viewpoint is.
Yeah, I wrote emo band in the
Blink 182
in the gutter a couple of times here. Like, oh, that'd be really good. Like screaming that into a microphone would be really. We should do that at the end instead of our favorite part. Find an emo part and scream it into the, like, you were.
Hell yeah.
That should be the playout of the last episode of the season, as everyone picking their favorite line and doing a screamo version of it. And that's, like, how you play us in and play this episode in and out. That'd be great.
Instead of the weird, like, I found some contemporary fado that I used as the music for this for now. We should just replace it with, like, what is the emo band closest to Pessoa this week?
Yeah, Jesus. My Chemical Romance shows up 1 week. You're like, oh god, yeah. Here it
isn't
comes.
It My Chemical Romance most every week, but
pretty much. Yeah.
I've never heard of My Chemical Romance song.
I don't know.
Oops. Yeah, we played a fair bit at the store actually as we close at night. But I also, most of my staff is like 24, so like My Chemical Romance was their first like big band love sort of thing. But I enjoy it. Wow. It's fun.
Yeah, cool.
But we could take some Pessoa lines and write them on pieces of cardboard and go march in front of Congress and Supreme Court. Like page 15, "Woman is a good source of dreams. Never touch her."
I underlined that same one.
Oh my
god. We're going to go with Pessoa and just be like, "Hey guys, look at this. It's from 1913. There's a lot of different ways that you could take this text and bring it out to the, you know, it could be screamo bands, it could be women's rights protests.
Is this the most Twitter friendly book ever?
Yes, that's a really good point. It lives on one character so like, at a time.
Even when I was reading, I was like, I could just quote any number of these, and you could put it on Twitter, and people would be like, retweet, feels that's speaking to me.
I was actually thinking about like all the Instagram poets when I was reading this. I mean, it wouldn't work for that for the specific reason that it isn't there's enough affirmation to it. Like,
oh, that's true.
They want the Instagram poets are really popular because they like give you the darkness, but then give you something to like really look forward to that you can tattoo on your skin and not feel like completely insane about. But you should.
You probably should. So I'm gonna try this as an experiment because I don't really use my Instagram very often. And I don't think that many people are watching us live, so I can pull this off before they hear it, or even if there's not that many people listening. But on page 46, I'm going to make an Instagram poet post that just says, "Postpone everything. Never do today what you can put off until tomorrow. You don't have to do anything tomorrow or today." See if I can get some traction.
That one's going to blow up.
It's perfect. It's perfect for that. Like it also reminded me, have you ever read Albert Kosseri?
No. I feel like Jeff Waxman was really into Coaster.
Jeff Waxman was really into him. Jeff was one of the people who turned me on to him. But he had he wrote like six novels over his lifetime. But he two of them came out almost simultaneously from New Directions and from New York Review of Books. And I can't remember the titles of either one right now. But his big thing was that he was that came through in his books and was his personal life philosophy was to be as lazy as possible, accomplish as little as possible to get by. That was the best way to live, was to do nothing, which I really greatly appreciate, and reminds me of the old Church of the Subgenius, which is a real callback for anyone out there who is old and into weird pseudo-religions. But there's this great pseudo-religion called the Church of the Subgenius that was based on the idea of slack, and that the better you were at slacking, the more good things would come to you. And that's sort of not that far away from this guy either. Like, just don't do shit, man.
I've got one for you, Chad. Do the one that says on bottom of page 15, seeing and hearing are the only noble things that life contains.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
And put that above that, put a picture of Kanye West and Kim Kardashian's ass. And put that on Instagram and just see if people like, yeah, you know, I like listening to him and seeing her. Those are the best things in life. We're good to go. Like, it's like
actually back on page 46 again, just down from what you quoted, Chad, become an absurd sphinx in the eyes of others. Shut yourself up in your ivory tower, but without slamming the door, for your ivory tower is you. But do that one, but put like the a tarot card image behind it, like the tarot card of like the tower. Ooh, you know, yeah. So like you're like combining, you're pretty much hitting everything in that moment. You got a sphinx in there. I mean, you've got tarot. Yeah. I mean, this is internet catnip.
And you're right. Like, this is how I'm gonna get friends and
this is how I'm gonna make friends.
But but on a related note, so another idea would be and what are those stupid, it's like they're those like successories or whatever, that store that sells like those posters that have like, you know, you can do it. My ex-wife loves this shit. But we should make Pessoa-isms and make posters with these phrases on them. I'll bet a bunch of bookstores and book nerds would buy those.
In a heartbeat.
Yeah.
You should show up to Winter. You should show up to Winter Institute with a couple like crates of those and see what you can do.
Yes. That would be perfect. If I were New Directions, I would make a t-shirt out of one of these.
Oh, make a t-shirt out of the cover. I mean,
have that on the front and then have one of the sayings on the back. That's one of the, like, not the Saddest Book of Portugal one, because that's like, that's fine, but I like these other ones much better. They're much more. Did you guys have, I thought it might be, this is going to be a hard book to talk about over these weeks because it does not have something that you can break down aside from like the general perspective, but I thought it would be interesting if we each chose like one of the sections that we thought was particularly stood out to us, and that might be a way of like kind of breaking it down a bit.
Well, I might be completely wrong, but I thought the very beginning of this, when it starts with Our Lady of Silence and the glorification of the Baron, and those parts reminded me a lot. They're very steeped in kind of religious imagery. There's obviously all the church, the stained glass, all that kind of stuff. But it reminded me a lot of biblical poetry, like Song of Solomon.
Mm-hmm. Oh, interesting.
And the way it sounds, the way it's written, and even the having the little headings before the poem starts, because to me it felt like it was very reminiscent of Song of Solomon.
It's funny that you say that, because the Our Lady of Silence one, at one point
that's an emo band name, by the way.
God, yeah. It's like Our Lady is opening for Our Lady of Silence.
On the Disquiet tour.
On the Disquiet. Oh,
oh man.
Perfect. We're going to have someone from Disquiet, the literary conference that takes place in Lisbon on here, since it's named after the Book of Disquiet. But when the Lady of Silence parts, I thought for a minute, is this about the Virgin Mary? Because says like, it's always like saying like horror of real women, blah, blah, blah. I can imagine you both as a virgin and a mother because you are not of this world. The child you hold in your arms was always a tiny infant. Since you were never other than you are now, how could you be anything but a virgin? But that, I know it isn't, but like I marked for a second, like this sounds like he's talking about the Virgin Mary, virgin mother of all silences, hearth and home of shivering souls, guardian angel of the abandoned. Like, and that sort of ties into what you're saying, Brian, of it seeming like having this religious sort of imagery or like that sort of cadence and symbolism. But that came through to me in that way.
But that could also be like talking about Artemis, you know, Diana. Yeah. I kind of took it more as sort of the imagined lover in his head, though he would never use the term lover because that's not supposed to happen ever.
Yeah. Don't do that.
Barren and sterile.
Don't act.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it was. It is about
virginity. Right.
Clarify
well,
that.
Well, but I was actually just thinking like, what is it? Luis Camoes. I'm not as familiar with his poetry, but I'm wondering how much of that tradition is being expressed here at the same time. You know, like the symbolism as such, but I can't really go too much into that. It just felt like a lot of this was making reference to other major figures in the Portuguese canon and playing with them a little bit. But I don't know. I could be. That's
I don't know. Like for dead end. So, like on page 7, your hands are like caged doves. Your lips are silent turtle doves, which my eyes can see cooing. All your gestures are birds. You are a swallow when you stoop down, a condor when you look at me, an eagle when your ecstasy is a proud and different woman, like blah, 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 blah. You know, it goes on like that. And then like the poetry of Solomon goes something like, the work of the hands of a skillful workman. Your navel is a rounded goblet. It lacks no blended beverage. Your waist, a heap of wheat set to the lilies. Your breasts like fawns, twins of a gazelle. Your neck like an ivory tower. Like it has the same style of imagery. And I wonder if he was playing off of biblical poetry here, talking about like the ideal lover, although it's not a, you know, but not a lover, but I don't know. It was just something that like sparked for me.
But that's also interesting because like, and going back to the other translations and like compilations of this book, the Penguin Classic edition starts with the Bernardosaurus portion, right? And that's about like page 200 in here. I went looking for it. And it immediately starts with commentary about being of a generation that has lost all belief in God.
Yes.
So if you're doing this on like a spectrum, like if you're following this chronologically and you're making reference to the time lapse between 1913 and was it like 1928 or so 30, for the
28, 30 something. Yeah.
A little bit of shit went down between there.
There's a few things. There might have been a war. I think it happened in 1916. I'm not sure exactly. Some guy's cousin got like taken out. Like it was really kind of lame, actually.
A very minor player. A country that I don't even know exists anymore.
Yeah.
That is not disqualifying. You can say that about just about every country.
You know, but related to like, if you're trying to force us into like being able to read it sequentially or whatever, this opening, like you're referencing the song Solomon and like that sort of bit, but it also has this sort of evocative stuff of like the old epic poems where he's sort of like calling out to like this imaginary dream like mother giving birth to that's both capable of giving birth and also like virginal and pure and perfect, and it's almost giving birth to this heteronym who then doesn't want to do anything because leaving that space is something active that will disrupt and disquiet their purity or their wholeness. So it doesn't
the invocation
tie into like other parts of like literary history and of approaches in that way, and can be, there's a way that you could read this as a sort of, no, this is a development of a character. Almost like reading someone's live journal blog during their emo pen years. They're just trying to find, he's just trying to find his way, man.
Yeah.
It'll all be okay one day. There's
an interesting line of like, you are a woman from before the fall, formed out of the first mud of paradise.
Yeah.
So it's not even human, though, like what he's talking about.
Yeah.
Not yet.
It's primeval and like pre-everything. And that's sort of like setting that up as an ideal is because it is something that's dangerous in terms of like life, because you'll always be disappointed. And there does come like the sense of like everything's absurd, everything's sort of a disappointment in the real life because it's not this perfected illusionary dream that I can have. If I stay with my dreams, things are better.
That's why I love this line later on 19 that says, I'm offering you this book because I know it is both beautiful and useless.
I have that exact same one marked, yeah. Teaches nothing, preaches nothing, arouses no emotion.
Yep.
And then again, in terms of like the whole repetition and like throwing everything into the book that you find, I mean, on 35, right below the section I mentioned earlier, it says, and above all, because I defend uselessness and the absurd, I'm writing this book in order to give the lie to myself to betray my own theory. Like this just sort of, there's a fugue quality to the writing where it's not just like, developing themes almost. It's more like it is a repetition and a development of the theme. Real quick, I just want to ask you, Chad, I texted you about this the other day. Why is there always some sort of ox or cow in the sections that I come on here to talk about? Because on page 35, we get Pedro's eclogue, and you, the little ox herd, and a huge, gentle ox were both walking calmly along the broad strip of the road. And I swear to God, I read that and had a flashback to the invented part and the green cow. I got to tell you, man, like, I don't know. It seems a little deliberate at this point.
That's so funny. You sent that and I was like, what section is he talking about? But I didn't get to that line until last night.
Yeah, well, there it was.
And that's it. That's so funny. You are Bovine. You should just
take
that as your new name.
Yeah, Bovine. That'll be my heteronym, Bovine.
Yeah. Hey, man, it's that Midwest culture, all those casseroles, starchy potatoes.
Yeah, our pizza is a casserole.
So, yeah
that's true.
Even your pizza is a casserole.
It's pretty true.
You guys drink Malort. I mean, come on.
Duh, don't say that word again.
By the way, did Dubrovka have any of that when she was in town?
I didn't see her. I wasn't able to make the event that night. I saw Andrew, and Chad was annoyed with me that I didn't make
Anthony.
Andrew take... Sorry, Anthony. Chad was a frustrated that I didn't make Anthony take Malort at 10:45 in the morning on a Monday.
Yeah.
Like, dude.
I thought it's an aperitif.
Yeah, it's good for you. It's like, it wakes you up.
I'm not saying it's not any of those things. I'm just saying it's a little early in the day, in the week.
No. It's great for brunch.
That's a false statement. Like it is, okay. Is never, never too. If you would have indoctrinated him by giving him Malort at 10:45 on a Monday morning, I would have given you the most amount of praise possible. We would have
missed opportunity.
Missed opportunity for sure. The other section, the section that I liked the best, I think, was number 21 because it was like the most just pure depression one, which I thought was pretty fun. That's the most live journal one for me. Painful interlude.
I put next to it Chad with a question mark.
That's exactly what.
It's like, let's see what kind of pain and suffering Chad's going to hone in on.
Yep.
And go yes.
Yes. Exactly. Oh God, that was that. There was one other one that I thought, yeah, this is perfect. It's like, where is it?
I lie recumbent in my life, and I
hear
even
it.
Know.
I find no consolation even in pride. What reason have I to be proud if I am not the creator of my? Oh my God, I didn't even think about that till just now. That's amazing.
We just found Chad's back tattoo.
Just the whole passage.
Just Pessoa with a little thought bubble. Like, everything is dumb. And
walk into the tattoo shop and the artist is like, wait, what? What am I doing here?
Oh, man. Yeah. So I don't know if there's anything else really to add here. Oh, I do have one. The one that summed it up for me in terms of his whole perspective is on page 36. I suffer and I dream.
Mm-hmm. Sure. I like it. Also on page 15, my dreams, since I create my friends and my dreams, I walk with them. And it reminded me of, like, why does this guy have so many heteronyms? Why isn't he right for himself? And this whole dreaming and not touching, and it's like a way of distancing yourself, like one more filter between you and the work, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, very much so. So do you guys have a favorite line do you want to share? And you used yours, Tom.
I did.
I got a kick out of this one. I really honed in on that, the saddest book in Portugal by Fernando Pessoa's own blurb for his book. It's on here. Mm-hmm. But on page 17, wanting to go to die in Peking and not being able to is something that weighs on me, like the idea of some imminent cataclysm. Talking about money, right? And how money gives you freedom. And it's like, well, I can't even choose where I want to go die.
Yeah.
It's not like I want to buy something cool. It's like, what if I want to go die over here? I can't afford it. That's a great cataclysm.
That sucks.
Oh, man. That's a guy that's about to get thrust into World War I.
Yeah.
Just
Yeah. It's about to go wrong.
Everything's about to go wrong.
Oh, page 19 also has a pretty choice one at the very top. It's as if someone were using my life to beat me with.
Oh, God.
I mean, you want to go dark. You want to go like, okay.
Yeah.
You can create a meme with that one. That's a good one to create a meme with, Chad.
Yeah, that one is. That's got to be there.
There's probably seven or eight Cubs players that you could put that one with.
Hell yeah.
There we go. There it is.
I got cut off when I started trolling you about your Cubs dynasty.
Yeah. Well. No, the thing about the Instagram posting though, Chad, is you kind of have to do it the heteronym style. Like you have to kind of like have one be more positive and one be the like dark and kind of get that going that way.
I can figure that out. The one that I was going to say, my favorite line is 28. Do not make the infantile mistake of asking the meaning of things and words. Nothing has any meaning.
Yeah.
Nothing makes sense. Nothing matters. Anyway, so I don't have anything else to add this week. I wrote down, went through all my notes.
No, I think it was a fun introduction, and I do see how people dip in and dip out because they're kind of, you know, just these little, you know, some are very like aphoristic, some are a little bit deeper, some like they're just different styles and flavors and little napkins in a chest somewhere that have been all plucked out and put together for us. So
yeah,
it's a lot of work. I'm glad somebody did that because I'm too lazy.
Yeah, I mean that had to be
put it together myself.
Maddening on some level, right? Yeah. Like just trying to get this into shape and then getting it translated and making like
Well, that's part of like one other thing noted that is that there are so many versions of this because it was like we're saying, but also it's like illegible. Like there's a lot of sections in here that have like the ellipses because they don't know what that was saying. And like even in the pictures in here, for anyone watching, you can see this or seeing it on YouTube, but like this is the more legible style of his writing, but this is like looks like garbage. Like it doesn't like it's real hard to deduce. And on some of these that are small or that whatever, it took a while, I think, for them to figure out what went together, but B, what it actually was written on there, and then get that into some sort of order. So going back real quickly to the Zenith translation for Penguin, we mentioned this last week too, but that one is organized. So it's Bernardo Soares is the author in that one as well. But it's organized thematically and uses, if there's a bit from the beginning section that ties in thematically and is sort of a revision, that can be combined. So they combine certain of these into one entry rather than having the one from Vicente Guedes and one from Bernardo Soares. So it's a little bit even muddier in that case because it does make it seem more like it's versions of things. Like
that's interesting. I don't, my initial reaction to that would be to say like that's somewhat illegitimate because you're taking such different pieces written at different points of time with different characters functionally. But why is that any more illegitimate than doing it, you know, sequentially?
Because
it's interesting.
Because that does bring up the question that I was trying to get at before too, of like if Pessoa had formed this into one book and wasn't, if he was a different sort of author, I guess, because he wouldn't, based on everything that we've said, he would just leave it in the trunk. But if he was a different sort of author and wanted to make this into one book, he probably would have combined some of those things or been like, this was the early version of this, but I like this phrasing. That's how writers generally tend to work. So it's maybe attempting to invent a version that Pessoa would have approved of. There are Pessoa scholars out there and fanatics who are listening to this who are like, you are wrong. You don't know what you're talking about at all. Which is always, I hesitate for someone like this because he does have his super fans who know everything. And I barely know any part of it.
But I mean, like the inventive part was a great book to do for the 2-month review, just because of its scope and how much there was to dig into. This one might almost be more perfect for this sort of approach in that like, it does make it more digestible. It does create through threads. Yeah.
You don't have to read the whole thing. You can read one section or no sections and you probably get it.
Yeah. Yeah. This is, and it's just, I mean, you guys talked about last week with Declan, but this is, you know, one of the most beautiful books that came out in the last few years. Like it's just as an object, amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I'm seeing if there's any explanation to how that was organized. Nope. doesn't have it. Anyways, okay, so for next week, we're going to be going over a bit longer sections, pages 47 through 94, and it's sections 40 through 81, the numbered sections 40 through 81. And we will be back for that. In the meantime, you can always follow us on Twitter at @open_letter or at Chad W. Post or at Brian Wood _. And Tom, you're at
Thomas K. Flynn on Twitter and Instagram and all that stuff.
And go to Volumes.
Yep, go to Volumes. At Volumes Books is all those handles. And yeah.
And you have a big project with Volumes coming soon.
The pop-up, you mean?
Or... Yeah.
We'll be running a pop-up shop in Water Tower Place in downtown Chicago. I think the start date might be the 22nd of this month, but don't hold me to that. But we'll be there through the holiday season. So I'll be there all the time. So if you're in town, swing by.
Selling a shitload of international literature.
Yeah.
I've got a whole bunch of your stuff queued up to come in for that. So
that's awesome. Yeah. So if you're looking for Christmas presents and you live in the Chicago area, go to the Water Tower Plaza, see Tom, ask for recommendation, buy 5 times that number of books that he recommends to you and support what your local.
That'd be fantastic.
Absolutely. And I'll be giving a reading at Volumes next year in October. Like, that's when my book comes out. I found out it's October. So okay. I'll come out and do Malort shots for each.
That sounds great.
Paragraph.
And you know, even if we don't get you on the schedule, we can just like have you stand in the middle of the store with a microphone and just or a bullhorn and just like declaim as loudly as possible.
And that'd shots.
Great. Yeah.
I mean, we'll have done the Malort will have happened beforehand. So like it'll be totally unintelligible.
Have you ever had that, Brian?
No, I have not.
Oh, fuck.
No. You're in for a treat.
You're in for
I just like saying it. That's all.
It does have a nice sound to it. It sounds like it tits. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, it does. Well, thank you guys for coming on here. And we'll be back next week with more Pessoa, more Book of Disquiet, and more everything.
Despair. More despair.
More Instagram poetry. More emo.
More live journal.
another week, another emo.
Hope dangles on a string, like slow spinning redemption, winding in and winding out. The shine of it has caught my eye and roped me in, so mesmerizing, so hypnotizing. I am captivated. I am vindicated.